Alright, I'm Carl from AT Consult. I built my first website in 96. And if you're wondering, that was the year that the Spice Girls had their first hit. And that everybody, including me, was dancing the Macarena. Can you imagine that? And if you're now thinking, Spice what? Macarena what? What is this guy doing on stage at Digital Elite Cup? Shouldn't he be farming in a retirement home or something? And then in 2001, I founded AG Consult, and we're a usability and information architecture company. And I had the honor to work for a lot of clients, big names, smaller names. And today, I'm going to talk not about conversion optimization, but how to make sure your new website won't be a fail. And the reason why I'm doing that is because I have the feeling that in the conversion world, a lot of people are like, oh, redesign's bad, not good. And I tend to agree, but not all the time, because redesigns aren't always a bad idea. And I know some of you are now thinking, but Carl, what about the Marks and Spencer case? They invested 150 billion, billion, that would be a lot, million, even million British pounds. It's quite enough money, and they lost 8% of sales. Well, I don't think that the redesign as such was the problem, but the fact that, and that is what Paul said, they didn't do user research. They didn't go out. They were just sitting behind their desk like, yeah, what shall we do? And that is the problem with a lot of redesigns. If you don't do user research, you're gambling. But that's the same with conversion optimization. If you're not doing your user research, you're gambling, and most of your tests will fail. And that's why we have those frameworks, like the Research Excel framework, Infinity framework, and so on. So redesign, bad. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. If your redesign is just what it is, redesign, then it will probably suck. If it's just a new paint of a new layer of paint, that won't solve your problems. It's the same thing if you have a glass of milk in your fridge and you want to drink it, and you say, oh, the milk is sour, and then you're thinking like, oh, what shall I do? And you take a new empty glass, and then you pour the milk from the old glass in the new glass. And then you're like, oh, the milk is still sour. And that's what a redesign is about, because most of the time, the biggest problem of a website is not the design, but is the structure and the content, and you should tackle that. And indeed, I hate the traditional redesign cycle, where every few years you have a new website, and most of the time it's cosmetic surgery. It doesn't answer new business needs. I don't know who you are. If you're an agency, I don't like you. Well, because traditional web agencies, they have told their clients, they made them believe that this is the redesign cycle. And every few years, you have a new site, and it will be better and better. And at the end, you will reach the pot of gold. But reality sucks. Because you have a new website, and it crumbles down, and then you have a new one, and it crumbles down again. So yes, I do believe in continuous improvement. But sometimes I believe in redesign. Well, maybe not redesign, but in a new website. And hold on to your horses, because this may be shocking news. Reason number one when someone needs a new website is they don't have a website yet. What? On a more serious note, most websites suck donkey balls. I was looking for a photo with this slide, and then I thought, maybe not. Like I told you, most of the time, structures and content are a disaster or a problem. At a certain moment in time, we were working for the Red Cross in Belgium. No, it was the Red Cross in Flanders. We have 6 million people living there, and the website of the Red Cross had more than 88,000 pages. Then you're in trouble. And then the classical conversion rate optimization approach won't help you. If you have a website with almost 200 navigation items, and I'm not even talking about those ones hidden in the humongous drop-down menus, then you have a problem. If you have a website with almost a depth of 30 levels of content, you have a problem. And that's what we see a lot with non-profit organizations, B2B websites, and government agencies. And of course, you need a redesign when you have really outdated technology. If your website is still made in Flash, or woohoo, Microsoft homepage, or it doesn't work on mobile and stuff like that, or similar things, yes, you do need a redesign. Because, and I know those sites can be optimized, but I hope that it's not the goal of you conversion optimizers to make a shitty website a bit less shitty. That is not why we're in this business. And third reason is, yes, and you've heard about this several times, when your website reaches its local maximum. And if you have a shitty website, you will hit that local maximum rather sooner than later. And yes, you do need a new website. And this is what I really believe. You can see I'm not a graphic designer. But continuous improvement, and sometimes you need a new website to go to the next level. If you have a weak foundation, it's impossible to have a strong website. I thought Paul would use a similar slide in his talk, but he didn't today. Damn. Two cases to illustrate this approach, and then I will explain the methodology. The first one is a website, Visit Ostende. It's a tourism website of a city called Ostende at the Belgian coast. And we were working for them, I think, 2 or 3 years. This is what we ended up with. The website was already there, and then we approached the local maximum. Because from user research, we know that people wanted other things. They wanted activities linked together. So what can I do with my kids? What can I do with my kids when it's better weather? And that was impossible. On a technical level, it was not possible. So that meant that we needed a new website. The website is now 1 year old, and it's not 2 minutes ago, but it was last Thursday that Peter, who is the boss of the website, tweeted his number, and now they have 25% more page views, unique sessions, and things like that. They have 4 times more subscribers to their newsletter. The app is used many more times. So yes, it was a success, and we could never have done this without a new website. Some people who know me are now waiting for, Carl, are you going to talk about Suzuki? Yes, Chris. I am going to talk about Suzuki, but only for 3 slides. If you want to know more about Suzuki, go to my slides. They're full of Suzuki cases. But this is how we inherited the Suzuki website. I think it was 8 years ago. It was a horrible website. It used frames. It used Flash. The car model pages were just a photo of a car model and then a download link. So it was not possible to make it better. We did some user research, we ended up with this basic concept. It had a slider in there. Go to my website, how we removed the slider later on. But the new website worked. We had the bounce rate were halved, we had an increase in conversion, and this new website allowed us to do a lot of conversion optimization work. This is where we are now, so I think, yeah, we did something. And once again, this was not possible with the old website. We could never have reached that. So that is why redesigns are important. Now, just to get things straight, most of you are optimizers, I guess, or in the optimizer business. Our approach to CRO, a summary of a summary, we identify the problem areas in the website, Google Analytics and stuff like that. Then we use tools, we do some user testing to see why it is a problem. Then we try to find a solution, can be changes in copywriting, can be new landing pages. If we have enough visitors, we do an A/B test, and then we measure and try it again. Good news for information architects, or if you want to go in that business, the first thing you need to do when making a new website is user research. A lot of user research. And if you have done that, okay, then it's a bit of roadmap strategy, then you create a structure, and then you create mockups. We'll go into depth into those things. First thing, use research. Paul has already stressed this. Incredibly important. We need to have the facts. We need to have the data to silence all those people with opinions. We don't want websites made on based on gut feelings. We need data to shut down the old hippo, not the new one, but the old hippo. We want to end all those people that have fucking opinions. And it has been my crusade for 15 years. And I want to end it. Someone hungry? No. And then, when you talk about user research and you have a meeting, there will be always a marketing prick or a would-be designer dickhead referring to,
yes, Carl, but Henry Ford said, nah.
And then I say, Oh, you're not a man or girl of the world. Because Mr. Ford never said this. The first mention in history of this so-called famous quote dates from 2002. The man was quite dead at that time, and it was 1 year after Jacob Nielsen and Don Norman, the godfathers of UX, wrote an article, "The First Rule of Usability, Don't Listen to Users." A very good article, but what a fucking shit title. Because now everybody is, see, they tell you you don't have to listen to users. Users are not important. And then you have Steve Jobs saying things like, a lot of times people don't know what they want until you show it to them. And then all those marketing people are, hey, see, Steve Jobs, Apple, the big brand, they didn't care about users. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, don't ask them what they want. That's wishful thinking. People cannot formulate what they want. That's the difference, because Apple doesn't do, well, they don't publicize a lot about market research. I'm not sure they don't do it, but they do a lot of user research. That's a fact, and that's what you have to do. Do your user research. The most important thing for user research is paying attention to what users do. Then maybe ask why they do it, but don't ask them how they would solve it, because they can't formulate those things. And that is what user research is about. And that's different from market research. As a user researcher, we never use or we don't believe in focus groups, people chatting to each other, interviews, always a dangerous method. So we use more data-driven methods. And I'm not going to talk about Google Analytics in depth, but we use it all the time. What we do for information architecture, and especially for those government agencies, nonprofits, and B2Bs, not, is looking at least visited pages. Because those websites, they have a lot of rubbish on them. And we have to find out what kind of pages are never visited. We need to get rid of all that fluffy stuff. And of course, we have user behavior tools nowadays. Scroll heat mapping, click heat mapping, user session recordings for Missimo, for form analysis, who will learn us a lot of things. But for me, and that's probably because I'm a usability guy, but I love user testing. It's one of the most important things, and especially when you want to make a new website. And I love moderated user testing. Real. I still call it real user testing. You can do it remote, you can do it the classical way, but real moderated user testing. See what your users do, and maybe ask them some questions. And if you give a task to users, think about the task. It's the most common problem. For example, on a holiday website, the most terrible question would be, oh, imagine you want to book a city trip to Barcelona on Valentine's weekend. There's probably a button saying city trips, and there's probably a banner crying, hey, Barcelona, Valentine, and then the user clicks and you're like, yeah, our website is fine. No! That's a fucking rubbish question. Never use words that are on the website, because then you are influencing the user, and you should make your question as personal as possible. What I would do in that case is, hey, where would you like to go next time for a few days? And then the person is like, yeah, I want to go to Rome. Well, go ahead. Then it's a personal question. He will forget that he's doing a user test. And the problem with question one is also, maybe his girlfriend or her boyfriend just broke up. And then you're talking about Valentine's weekend. And then they start crying in the middle of a user test. Maybe their father was robbed in Barcelona. And they're like, bah. And you screwed it up. So make good questions. And while you have your visitors there, let them do the same tasks on the websites of competitors. Learn from other companies. See what they like, dislike, where they struggle, where they smile on other websites. That is, for me, why user testing is so important. And yes, you can throw in some eye tracking, but that's just decoration. The most important thing is observing your users. Last method I really like, and don't write down this list like Pep told you, they will send you the presentations. These are some of my favorite questions on big websites. I really like this stupid question. Why are you here? For God's sake, what are you doing on our website? An open question, but they put it down in their own words. Don't do surveys like 17 questions, page 1 of 16. No, it's a 1, 2, 3 question survey. We don't ask for opinions, we ask for facts. In this case, and this is a traditional travel website, where you have the where do you want to go and when do you want to go? And all websites are like that. And this is TUI Belgium. They're like, yeah, Carl, this is how our business works. And then we did a survey and we asked people, hey, for the holiday you're looking for, do you already know when do you want to go, where do you want to go? And these were the results. It seems that a lot of people don't know where they want to go. A lot of people don't have fixed dates in their minds. They have maybe a time frame, like, yeah, I want to go in the holiday season or in the Christmas season, and I want to go somewhere where it's hot. Well, good luck on this website when you want to go somewhere where it's hot in Christmas season. Ding dong! It won't happen. And that's why you need to do your user research. That's why you need to go outside. Other questions are like, what convinced you the most to buy this product? Was there something that almost stopped you from buying from us? And from recent clients, we always ask a stupid question. I think it's a funny question. It's like, what would you miss the most when you took away your, and in this case, it's a carport, when you took away your carport. And indeed, people do have feelings for their carport. Well, not the way you're thinking now, but they were like, okay, I hated it when I had to unload my groceries in the rain, and I hate when I needed to scrap the ice from my car. And that's the content you can use for your new website. Then you know the real needs of your customers, and that is, and you can use it for conversion optimization and for making new websites. What's it all about? Stop selling the way you want to sell yourself, and start selling the way people want to buy from you. That should be our goal, whatever we do. And I know we all love tools. But finally, to connect the dots, you have to use the most important tool there is in our business, your brain, your common sense. And that's what it's about, but you have to do your research first. Okay, and then after the user research phase, we have something called strategy and roadmap. For me, the most important things we do in that phase is like deciding what should be on the website, but also what should not be on the website. That's the most important thing. Cut the crap. And of course, there's a role of the website as a business tool, the role of the website in the communication and marketing mix. But for me, for today, that's not the most important thing. I want to tell you how we go from idea to prototype, and once again, how you can involve users to make sure that the concept you create is as good as possible, that it's not a Marks and Spencer thing where you lose 8% of sales. Start with the structure, mock-ups, and yes, we can do a lot of user testing. And maybe, we can throw in some A/B testing. Use your common sense to make a structure. Most of the times you have common sense. I hope you have common sense. But sometimes maybe there are problem areas within a website. And there are two things, and these are the old methods, when people lay in cards, the open card sorting and the closed card sorting. In short, what does it mean? You write down the topics of all pages or all products or whatever you have on your website on little notes. With open card sorting, you ask people to lay down the things, or group the things together that they think do belong together, and you ask them to name them. I prefer a bit of closed card sorting, where you have done some basic thinking and you already lay out some labels, but you allow people to make more labels. Yes, Pep, 10 minutes will do, I think. this is the moment I feel confident, and then it's like, oh, fuck, only 2 minutes left. So people lay down labels. We also allow a stack with I don't care and I don't know. That's good. This is very time consuming. Luckily, we're in the internet business. There do exist online tools, and I love Optimal Sort from Optimal Workshop. This is an example. This is for a job website, so these are the categories. These are the different job titles, job postings, and you can allow people to drag and drop things to the categories they want. And that will help you to see how people think and what if your basic idea works or not. This is an example of university in Belgium. So once again, these are the themes. This is the result of the card sorting. And these are the different courses you can follow. You see, most of the times we were pretty okay with our themes because here 62 people put it there. So there's no problems. But here, ding dong, We have cross-media management, 25 people put it in the economics and management branch, and 26 in informatics and multimedia. We also have a big problem here, graphic design, informatics and multimedia or art. But this shows you what categories are okay and what categories do need more thinking. Maybe you should make the labels clear, maybe you should put them together, maybe you should split them. But that's what you can do with card sorting. If you have open card sorting, this will be the result of your exercise. The software will group things together, say this is what most people put together, and mainly your job is to put labels on these items, and then you can start testing. So that's the first step we do. Second test is tree testing. Once again, we use, and I only know Optimal Workshop, but we use TreeJack, also from Optimal Workshop. You can upload your tree structure. You can ask questions. Where would you find this? Where would you click to that? And you can see where people click. Dang. We aim for an 80% success rate. Then we're lucky. And why is this important to do tree testing? Because when the first click, when people, the first click is a right click, they will reach their goal three times more than when the first click is a wrong click. Once again, you see the numbers, direct fails, indirect fails, and stuff like that. You can go more into depth, but these are the tools that are available to make sure that people will understand the structure of your website. And what we also do is, because even we, internally, sometimes we have different ideas. Sometimes our client says, no, my idea is better. You can do two or three tests with different structures, and so you will see that different ideas will have good points, and you can maybe put them together. Once you finish your structure, you make a mock-up. And that's where it goes wrong all the time. Then people create mock-ups full with lorem ipsum bullshit text, and things like, here comes title 1, 2, 3, 4. And if you make a mock-up like that, it will always look beautiful, because everything will fit in it, because you're not using real texts. It's very important, if you make a mock-up, that you use real copy. It should not be the final copy, but it should be as good as possible. Then you can really see, will it work or will it not work? Don't do the bullshit thing, because then later on when you make the design, you will have troubles. And for the designers among us, please, if you don't care about words, you're a decorator. You're not a designer. If you create mock-ups, you should also care about words, because that is essential part of your interface. As optimizers, you should know that words are very important. Once again, mockups, you're not. You should build in some humility. Test them. There are a lot of screenshots testing tools available, click testing tools available. You can do 5-second tests. You can ask questions when you upload your photos, your screenshots. What have you seen? What do you think this page is selling? Or where would you click? In this case, it's a homepage. Where would you click to find that? And you can use that for different reasons. This is an example of an insurance company. And this was the question. You just bought an apartment and you want to get an insurance for it. This was version A, the boring version, with a top task there. Then there were themes and sub-themes, and you could click here. And for this question, you could click on the house or on this one that reads my house, where I live. Then there was version B, more directed by the client, and there was a big banner on top with a guy laying down in his new apartment and a sentence, insure your apartment and only pay per square kilometer. No, yeah, that's how we live in Belgium, per square kilometer, per square meter. And then you could also click here, the house, and then of course, because an image says so much more than 1,000 words, Carl, there's some images above the themes, and then... there were the results. 3% of people clicked on the banner. And of course, people clicked on the other items. The failure rate was about 40%. In the boring version, sorry, designers, and this is not a final design, it's a mock-up, failure rate was only 20%. And some people will think, yeah, Carl, no shit, Sherlock, banners do not work. And I know that banners do not work, but I think it's our job to convince our clients once again and again and again and again that these things do not work. That is our job. As designers, as information architects, as optimizers, we should fight not against our clients, but we should fight to convince them for what's right and don't allow them to make bullshit websites. And then you can do some user testing on your mockups. Not on a beta version, not on When it's programmed, do it on a static version. It's so much cheaper to change things on a static version than once it's programmed. And maybe you can use some A-B testing. This is a website that we did work on. The guy doesn't sell wedding dresses online. It's a physical shop. I think it's the biggest bridal shop in the Netherlands. And we have to work on this website. We created lookbooks so people could download things. And we were a bit afraid of the left-hand navigation. So for creating the new website. But we noticed that a lot of people were clicking there and was like, is it good or is it not good that they go to different pages on this website? Well, let's test it. Just do an A-B test. In this case, this was a big winner. We had now 22% more people going to the contact page and making an appointment. So this ensured us that for the new version we wanted to make, indeed, we could leave out the left-hand navigation. And that's how we do it. That's how you should do it. Maybe not exactly the same methodology, but use your users. Use your audience for that website. Don't be the prick. Don't be Mr. Know-it-all. And yes, you've made those mock-ups. You're almost there. The only thing that needs to be done is give your mock-ups to a designer and to a developer and say, hey guys, just make this. What can go wrong? And I really believe in this. And indeed, what can go wrong if you give it to a designer? That was my talk. Thank you.